In case you didn't know, I've been in and around the vulnerability management space for the vast majority of my career, which spans about 18 years. During that time, I've been on both the offensive and defensive side of the vulnerability coin. Starting out as a pen tester, then focusing on AppSec, I was at a company called White Hat Security. We used to spit out thousands of vulnerabilities that my team that I helped build verified each and every one before they went to the customer to eliminate false positives. Because guess what? Even now in 2025, I was doing that back in the early 2000s. Even now, fast forward 2025, false positives are a nightmare. No matter how good our security tools get, they spit out a ton of noise. So how we solved it at White Hat back when I got there, I think it was 2009, was we had a room of people that I sat in that would look at all the output of our scanner that said, hey, we think that this is cross-site scripting. We think that this is SQL injection. And we would verify. We had a playbook of how to manually verify each and every one of those. As we got more customers, that team needed to grow. I opened our Houston office. I hired up to about 65 people at the Threat Research Center, most of which were either performing manual penetration tests or verifying output of our dynamic or static scanners, sometimes both. If you do not have the luxury of having a Threat Research Center of 65 people verifying the output of your scanner, and White Hat really in the way that it used to exist doesn't really exist anymore, you're kind of at the behest of these tools or burning consultant hours on doing that for you or whatever it is. Basically, what I've seen is either you have it or you don't, with the actual boots on the ground person hours to do vulnerability management right. Before I talk too much about my career, what we wanted to talk about today is I'm super interested in how AI is impacting a bunch of different verticals in cybersecurity, and one of those is vulnerability management. So we're gonna get to peek behind the curtain of a brand new product that they reached out to me to take a look at it. I'm kicking the tires. I'm gonna kick the tires live. We're gonna do a bit of an unboxing to see what kind of the latest and greatest of this tech is actually up to. This is a sponsored video, but this is not a sales video. I don't work for this company. I just want to give you a look behind the scenes. I really like going to like the startup corner at Black Hat and see what all the new vendors are doing. Helps us stay at the tip of the spear. What are the new innovations out there? What's going on? I'm going to give you my honest opinion about everything that I see. We're going to kick the tires together. But first, why should you listen to me about vulnerability management? Fast forward in my career a number of years, I wound up running vuln management for Bank of America. I had an org of close to 100 people globally reporting to me to run those scans, triage those results, and then chase remediation and compliance with our SLAs internally. Separate from that almost 100 people, we had another couple dozen people that their job was to just rate vulnerabilities that were coming through the NVD, through the National Vulnerability Database. Because when a researcher reports a CVE, it's in their best interest to make it sound as critical as possible. This is like street cred for them. So the NVD, you know, will have a CVSS score out of 10, and they always skew as close to 10 as possible. There's some math nowadays in there that can kind of get that closer to reality. But at Bank of America, when I was there, we didn't trust anyone external's ratings for one very specific reason. None of the math, none of the equations out there, none of the analysts out there know anything about our very unique, very large environment. So whether it was a CVE in a Bluetooth skateboard or an internet connected refrigerator, or it was a CVE in Struts or some other Java middleware, we had a team that were going to look at all of those and give an internal rating. And if that rating was high enough, spin up an incident. That's likely when my team would get contacted and say, hey, go find this vuln on our network. Fast forward from my time at the bank, and then I wound up running software security for Reddit. Part of that job included AppSec, and we tried our hardest. We tried all of the latest and greatest tools out there to try to find scanners that could find repeatably at scale vulnerabilities in our code base. And we had a really hard time. Even trying some tools that I think are truly good, we still were drowning in a false positive problem. And we really honestly didn't have the people on the bench with enough cycles to go through 4,000 false positives every time we ran a scan. So with that resume in mind, you can understand why I might be excited that there might be some AI agents that could have capabilities to help teams like that sort through all of this mess. And one of those products that just got announced is called Maze. They're specific to cloud vulnerabilities, but some of the stuff that they're talking about is some of the stuff that AI is actually good at. Early in the AI hype cycle, we saw a lot of like everyone throwing AI at everything and claiming it was magic. And then, you know, we're a few years into it at this point, and I think we're all starting to realize what they're actually good at. And if you follow this channel for a while, I've reviewed some AI socks, and I think those AI agents are similar in the, like, let's repeat some low-level investigative tasks for some sort of like sock alerts. Well, now put your vulnerability management cap on, and now we're looking about investigating vulnerabilities in the context of that environment. That same thing that I said I had dozens of people doing for raiding at the bank, and then hundreds of people executing, actually going and finding and fixing the vulnerabilities. What if we could have some AI agents that could take that raw vulnerability data from the scanners, from the National Vulnerability Database, whatever it is, and bring that with the context of your environment and start to act on it? So let's get off of their marketing page, get right into their dashboard. They did give me, this is early, super early access to their account. I think they went live. I'm recording this, and I think I just saw them post on LinkedIn today that they are live earlier. The founder posted. So it's cool that I got early access, but let's take a look. This is the actual dashboard. I'm actually logged into an account here. And the whole gist can boil down to, hey, you've got a ton of vulnerabilities coming from a ton of different sources, likely. How about we boil that down to the smallest sliver possible of things that you should actually be acting on. And then again, as you can see from these stats here, instead of relying on the CVSS score or whatever, you know, the vendor says is critical, Maze is doing some contextual analysis with their AI agent to decide what is critical and what is not. So you can see here from the 100,000 vulns that we had from various sources, you know, just pulling at the criticals, 2,400 of them were critical. What percentage of those ended up in the not exploitable pile versus the exploitable pile? Then we have things from high and medium even coming up and ending up into the exploitable pile. And then so we kind of have this end result of different numbers of criticals, highs, mediums, lows, exploitable, not exploitable, so on and so forth. So we have a greatly reduced number of things that we actually care about. So as we dig into the actual vulnerabilities page, we could sort by CVE or source or when it was investigated or the asset type that you're actually looking at. And you get a little summary of what the vuln actually is. But let's get into what I think is actually the most interesting part, the vulnerabilities that Maze is saying is exploitable. And I pulled up probably one of the more interesting ones that I found while digging through some of their vulnerabilities. And that's because this one, there's a clear mismatch between what the vulnerability scanner said was the severity or the risk and what Maze's conglomeration of agents decided was actually the risk and why this was actually exploitable. So right off the bat, we can see that the scanner called this one medium, which is in line with the CVSS score out of the NVD, National Vulnerability Database. Upon looking into it, I can figure out the reason why the scanner and the CVSS score probably said medium. If you go into their section that's called likelihood analysis, the first section here says that the attacker is blocked from direct network access because the container doesn't expose any ports, which is basically saying, hey, this pod that you have here isn't even on the internet, is not reachable by the attacker. So that's why we're saying, yeah, there's a vulnerability, but we're calling it medium because this is unreachable. But because we have the magic of context, right, that all these agents have about this whole cloud environment, they know that, hey, this vulnerability is actually exploited via a different parsing mechanism. You don't need to send this attack directly to a port exposed on the internet. This vulnerability is exploited via SQS messages, which, based on the knowledge and the context of the Maze agents, this pod is absolutely ingesting. So an attacker can get their attack into the SQS messages queue, which this pod will then ingest and be exploited. The other reason that's making this one critical versus medium is that public proof of concepts exist. This is a great additional layer of information. As you go down this attack path in the likelihood analysis, it gives you that further information. The attacker does have a direct and intended path to the vulnerable code, because the application is robustly designed to process XML from SQS queue, which is the exploitable business logic. The attacker's effort is dramatically reduced because of a public POC. And then they're saying that this container is actually of high value due to its IAM permissions. So then if we go into impact analysis, we can get deeper into that, saying the IAM role that's calling this one, you know, a high value target is actually access to AWS Secrets Manager. Kind of another interesting part of this vulnerability here, since it's like part of it is a denial of service attack. A lot of scanners would say, hey, this pod is part of a replica set in Kubernetes. I'm getting a little into the Kubernetes weeds here. But this basically means that if that pod goes down, it would just be immediately replaced because it's part of a replica set. So maybe you would care less about being able to denial of service, a singular pod, because in the replica set, it's just going to be immediately replaced and the whole application won't go down. But again, because of the context that we have about this application, what it's doing with XML ingestion and this SQS queue, as soon as that new pod comes online, it's going to start ingesting off of that SQS queue again. And guess what's sitting in there? The exploit. So that's what's going to cause this crash loop. Again, this is important information due to all of the context that Maze's agents have about this AWS environment that vulnerability scanners just couldn't possibly have. The vuln scanners are going to stop at basically, hey, that port is open or closed, that version number is whatever it is, too high, too low, and maybe a few other little bells and whistles, but no way to have all this additional context. That's really kind of the power of bringing the AI agents to vulnerability management. Let's switch over to the opposite, one that the scanners are calling critical, but Maze is saying is not exploitable. This is like equally, if not more valuable when you're equating for your security engineer's time of triaging all of this. False positives are kind of the bane of this work. So if we look at the CVSS score out of NVD, it's a 7.8, which is even higher than the 6.5 of the one that we just went over. The original scanner that spit this out called this critical, but Maze is saying, hey, this isn't even exploitable. Never mind critical, medium, low, whatever. No, this one, you could just ignore this one. So as I kind of just went over, where the vuln scanner stopped is, hey, this kernel version is vulnerable. There's a vulnerability in the version number, boom, vulnerability, critical, 7.8 high, whatever it is. But with the power of context, Maze can realize that a lot of the other prerequisites of exploitability are not met. Namely, this AF-XCP socket functionality is required in order for this vulnerability to exploit. And because of the access that they have to your box, these agents, they could say, hey, those parameters aren't found. This isn't being enabled. Another requirement is this BPF functionality, which is also completely disabled. And you can go into the timeline and actually see the commands that got run on the box and see where they gathered this evidence of, hey, none of this stuff is enabled. So this vulnerability would go absolutely nowhere. When I was on the phone with Maze and they were walking me through some of this, they said every time they do a POC or a POV, they run into a not exploitable example that there are AI agents spit out, that it's literally the scanner's flag of vulnerability that is like required to be exploited on Windows, and they're flagging it on a Linux environment just because the version numbers are different. I didn't show you one of those because that's pretty boring, but that just goes to show you the gap between like where we are with exploitability out in the wild in output of vulnerability scanners, and like the power of bringing AI agents in context is like so far beyond just like, hey, we're flagging stuff on the wrong operating system these days. They said they run into that in every single POC that they do. I'm not surprised. So right off the bat, those ones, easy peasy, right? We're going to, of course, have the context of the operating system. But then to go deeper and actually understand all these different flags that are necessary for that specific vulnerability to be exploited and be able to like go and see if those flags or settings are set or if something is in memory or not or whatever it is, that's what, these AI agents are actually able to do to build that correct context and scaffolding. So for me, this is a cool look at what AI agents are capable in and around vulnerability data. This is the first time that I'm seeing agents go after stuff like this. We've seen a lot of SOCs. We've seen a lot of offensive security agents going out and finding vulns. But this is the first time that, there's a lot of different agents under the hood there that could make all of those things possible. I also, in talking to the team, they have different things like remediation in the works that should be out soon. They literally just launched today. So this is just the beginning. I'm kind of excited to see what AI agents they come out with. This is the kind of thing that if you blink, you're left behind. I'm in some AI security groups. We all kind of share knowledge about what we're all working on. And I didn't pay attention for a few days and they've left me in their dust. So this is an industry moving fast. I'm really, really glad to see, we're kind of beyond that first everyone throwing AI at the wall and seeing what sticks and calling it magic. We're now to, hey, the tech and our ideas are starting to meld and our capabilities are starting to we're starting to get a better idea of the capabilities and what we can actually apply them to. And congrats, Maze, on the launch. This looks really cool. If you want to check them out, get a demo, tell them I sent you. They'll take extra special care of you. It would help the channel out greatly if you did that too. Thank you for watching. Thanks, Maze, for supporting the channel, and I'll see you next time.